Okay. Now we'll actually get to the parables or the sayings. Like I said, parable is a broader term than what we sometimes think of as parable. So some of the sayings here may be going, is that really a parable? But I covered that. I mean, it's there. There are these broader sayings. Now, as I mentioned in the introduction, Jesus not only announced the kingdom's arrival, but he gave powerful demonstrations of this heavenly invasion. In fact, Mark in his gospel, in just the first two chapters of his gospel, Mark reports that Jesus exorcises a demon, he heals Peter's mother-in-law, and he heals the multitudes of people in Capernaum. He cleanses a leper. He pronounces forgiveness of the paralytic's sins, and he heals the paralytic physically, and he ministers to a tax collector who's an irreligious outcast of the society. So just in the first two chapters of Mark, you have all of these reports of Jesus working these powerful miracles. Jesus' ministry, it was something that astounded people. And it created an absolute major buzz. Mark chapter 1 verse 22 notes that the people, they were astonished at the Lord's teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority and not as the scribes. Mark chapter 1 verse 27 and 28, it says, and they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, what is this, a new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. So they're recognizing something of the power at work in the ministry of Jesus, and his fame spread everywhere throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. Peter tells Jesus in Mark chapter 1, verse 37, that everyone's looking for him. Now you talk about a buzz. Everyone's looking for him. Mark chapter 1, verse 45, Mark reports that Jesus, he'd become such an attraction that he could no longer openly enter into a town, but he was in a desolate places, and even then people were coming to him from every quarter. So he was such an event, such an attraction, he couldn't openly go in because he'd be mobbed. So he's out in desolate places, and even out there, everybody's coming to him from all places. Mark chapter 2, verse 2, you have so many people are gathered at that home in Capernaum where Jesus is preaching, that even the door, you can't even get to the door. Can you picture the people just piled up and just flowing out? So that there's this huge crowd around this home because Jesus is there teaching. Mark says in chapter 2, verse 12, that after Jesus healed the paralytic, they were all amazed. And they glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. We never saw anything like this. This is what's going on in Jesus' ministry. And though his ministry had excited many people, it disturbed some other people. You see, some were accusing him of blaspheming in claiming to be able to forgive sins. And others questioned why he ate with tax collectors and sinners. You see, this was new. This was new, and it was contrary to tradition. Proper religious people just didn't say or do those kinds of things. So you've got this tremendous excitement and this buzz, and you've also got these negative voices of people saying, no, 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 there's something wrong here. And one of Jesus' departures from tradition that upset people was his breaking of the tradition of regular fasting. Now, the Old Testament, it prescribed a national fast on the Day of Atonement. That is something that God prescribed and something that all the people were to do. So you have that in the Old Testament. And it seems from 1 Samuel 14:24 and Jeremiah 36:6, that a fast also could be called in special times of penance, when there was an emergency or some kind of crisis going on. And several fasts had apparently become customary after Judah had been taken into exile to Babylon. You have a number of fast days that seem that they had become customary. fast days that seem to line up with days that were of particular significance during this Babylon's siege of Jerusalem. And you can see that in Zechariah 7, 1-5, and Zechariah chapter 8, verse 19. The late New Testament scholar Robert Gulick, in his commentary on Mark, he says of, well, this is what I should have put up first. We're going to look, remember I have the category, so we're going to look at a number of these. Jesus brings the kingdom, the bridegroom in their midst. Don't know why it broke off and started another line, but I could never figure out most of this stuff. But here's what Gulick says. Fasting was a common rite in Judaism with roots deep in the Old Testament. At times it was an expression of mourning for the loss of someone or something. 1 Samuel 31, 13, 2 Samuel 1, 12. More often it was an expression of contrition and penitence, a sign of repentance marked by the symbols of mourning. Combined with prayer, fasting was a statement of self-denial and self-humiliation, depicting one as self-effacing and submissive to God's will. So you see this has a long history, deep roots, and in the intertestamental period, fasting in Judaism really increased. It became more and more common. In Luke 5:33, he says the disciples of John fasted often. Luke 18:12, it indicates that the Pharisees fasted twice a week. So you see how this fasting is stepping up. Note also Anna's fasting in Luke chapter 2, verse 37. You see, fasting by the time of the first century in Judaism had become an expected mark of piety. This is how religious people did it. Fasting was a common mark, an expected mark of the pious. If you were religious, if you were devout, then you are somebody who is going to be engaging in all of these voluntary fasts. Pharisees did it twice a week. John's disciples fasted often. So that's what that was and how that was. But Jesus and his disciples, they did not engage in regular voluntary fasts. On the contrary, he was more associated with feasting. Jesus was more associated with feasting, so much so, in fact, that they accused him of what? Being a glutton and a drunkard. So much associated with feasting instead of with fasting that they said, this guy's a glutton and a drunkard. He's not acting piously. The pious we know are big on fasting. And he's not. He's not doing that. I mean, this was such an obvious difference between Jesus' disciples on the one hand, and John's disciples and the Pharisees on the other, that they come to Jesus and they demand an explanation of this glaring difference. Why do John's disciples and the Pharisees and pious people, why do they fast, but your disciples don't? What possible explanation can you have for this impious conduct of yours, not engaging in regular voluntary fasts that we all know religious, pious, righteous people do? What possible explanation can you have for that, huh? Explain that to us. Well, he's got an explanation. Oh, he's got one. You see, he's got one. And Jesus' answer to that question, what he tells them is theologically loaded. It is theologically loaded, you see, but it requires some background understanding to really grasp the significance of what Jesus just gave them. How are you going to defend this? And he goes, gives that to them. And when you see the weight of what's in what he tells them, I hope it is impressive to you. He tells them in Mark chapter 2, verses 19 to 20, and Jesus said to them, can the wedding guests fast? The wedding guests. We're at a celebration. We're at a wedding feast. Can the wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. And they would all understand that, as you'll see in a second. They would understand that at a wedding feast, nobody fasted. Completely, socially unacceptable to fast at a wedding feast. But he says the days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they'll fast in that day. But this day, the bridegroom is here, so fasting is completely inappropriate. According to Craig Keener, he's a New Testament scholar, he writes in the Dictionary of New Testament Background, Jewish wedding feasts, they normally lasted 7 days, and many of the closest associates of the bride and groom, they remained the full 7 days. Keener says, Jewish people emphasized joyous celebration at wedding feasts. I don't know how we perceive them, but how we perceive them isn't really helpful in trying to understand what Jesus is communicating. In that day, in that time, wedding feasts were something special. They were a joyous celebration. Text, documents, writings often use weddings to symbolize what? The greatest joy. So what were weddings a symbol of? This celebration, this feast, they were often used to symbolize the ultimate greatest joy. Well, that would make it a nice symbol of the kingdom. What? The ultimate joy. Okay, he says that they're symbolized the greatest joy in contrast to the epitome of sorrow, grief at a funeral. As one must mourn with the bereaved, one was also obligated to celebrate with the couple at a wedding. You see, fasting at a wedding feast would be no different than celebrating and dancing at a funeral. It would be so out of place, so socially unacceptable. It would just be completely crazy. Julius Scott, he writes in Customs and Controversies, Intertestamental Jewish Backgrounds of the New Testament, he says there were prescribed stages of the wedding celebration. Preparation of the bride, transfer of the bride from her father's home to that of the groom, the bride's introduction into the home of the groom, and blessings and festivities within the husband's home. The celebration included many guests, both invited and otherwise. Witnesses were required for the reciting of blessings throughout the week of the wedding. There were feasting in a general atmosphere of merriment and rejoicing. David Wenham, he says, the normal procedure seems to have been for the guests to gather at the bridegroom's house on the day appointed for the marriage. The bridegroom would go to the bride's home to claim her, and then he'd bring her in joyful procession to his own home. The eating and drinking would then begin and would often go on through the night. The coming of the bridegroom with his bride was thus the signal for the wedding feast to begin. So I want you to see, when Jesus says something about this, he says, why aren't they fasting like pious religious people fast? And he tells them that would be completely inappropriate in light of the moment, in light of what is happening, in light of the circumstance of who I am and what I am doing and what I am bringing. He says the disciples don't fast because the current period is like a celebration of a wedding feast. When the groom is present. David Wenham, I quote Wenham a lot in this lesson because I just think Wenham has a lot of good stuff to say. So that's why you're getting a lot of David Wenham. He's the fellow who taught the New Testament at Oxford for 24 years and wrote a book on the parables. He says the implication is that something joyful and significant, like a wedding, is taking place in Jesus' ministry, and furthermore, that Jesus is the bridegroom at the wedding, being the reason for the joy and celebration. So it's not simply some kind of great thing going on, a great time of joy and celebration that's divorced from him. He's the reason. He's the reason for the joy and celebration. So you have these things being combined. And the joyful and significant thing that's taking place in Jesus' ministry is the ushering in of the long-awaited kingdom of God. As I've emphasized, the kingdom of God was central to Jesus' ministry and teaching. Mark begins his account of Jesus' ministry. Mark in chapter 1, 14 and 15, he says, now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel, the good news of God, and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel, the good news. Well, what's the good news? The good news is that I'm bringing it and I'm here. Been waiting how long? How many people have looked and longed for this? So you talk about a cause for celebration, a cause for joy. And that's what Jesus is saying. I put these up, I think, last week. You see, in terms of the kingdom of God being central to Jesus' ministry, here's an example you just see over and over again. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. You go and proclaim the kingdom of God. That's what Jesus is here heralding. That's what he's announcing. And that's why Jesus says in a text I showed you last week, Jesus says in Matthew 13:17, he says, "For truly I say to you, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear it." Do you see him saying to them that something special is taking place, that you are privileged above all those other people, all of those great prophets, all of those righteous men that you read about, those men that you think so highly of? You are privileged above them because I am here and you are hearing something they would have killed to hear. Perhaps that's bad to say of a prophet. Let's say they would have died to hear. That you are hearing things and seeing things. R.T. France, he's a well-known New Testament scholar, he says about this text in his commentary on Matthew. He says, "The prophets looked forward to the day of eschatological," you know that means end time, study of last things. Eschatological is just last, eschatos, last, okay. Eschatological restoration. What do you mean rest? The fixing, the healing. The end-time restoration of the broken creation. And he says, the prophets look forward to the day of eschatological restoration, to the coming of what Jesus now calls the kingdom of heaven, but saw it only in prefiguration and promise, not in existential reality. Like Abraham, who rejoiced to see my day, John 8:56. Abraham rejoiced to see Jesus' day. Why? Why? Why did all these prophets and all? Because he's coming as the one, the Messiah, the kingdom bringer. God's intervention to set all things right. He says, like Abraham, who rejoiced to see my day, the prophets spoke of the grace given to you, aware that their service was not for their own benefit, but for yours. Things which even angels are agog to get a glimpse of. 1 Peter 1:10-12. There is an incredulous wonder running through these New Testament reflections on the privilege of those who live at the time when God's saving purpose comes to fruition. David Turner, another New Testament scholar, in his commentary on Matthew, he comments on that same text, Matthew 13:17. He says, "The disciples are graciously blessed with seeing eyes and hearing ears. This blessedness exceeds that of many prophets and righteous people who long to hear and see what the disciples have heard and seen." Jesus' disciples are privileged to experience the eschatological words and deeds of Jesus that inaugurate the kingdom. You see, this is something tremendous. That's why Jesus says, what are you talking about fasting? Who would be fasting now? That would be like having somebody fast at a wedding feast. It's crazy. Because you don't understand what is taking place in my ministry. You don't understand the significance of who I am and what I'm doing. That's the only reason you could ask such a question. But I'm saying to you, what is occurring here in my ministry is this great, glorious, tremendous, long-awaited, breathtaking ushering in of the kingdom of God. It is a time for celebration. Certainly not a time for mourning and a time for fasting. Now, linking the kingdom to a feast, that's not at all surprising. In light of texts in the Old Testament, for example, like Isaiah 25:6-8, says, "On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast." You say, why would you use feast? You know, you and I live in a world where we just bop down to the supermarket and buy a roast or something. People didn't always live this way. People didn't always get to go and eat all the meat they wanted. It wasn't a world like that. So when you talk about a feast, you say to somebody, man, this is like a celebration where you get to eat to your heart's content. The finest food. You may go for years and years without ever having that food again. But he says here, on this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well-refined. And he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Are you seeing the consummation? He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. So this idea of representing the kingdom and the bringing of the kingdom in terms of a feast is not at all odd. You see, and people on their toes would say, okay, I see the tremendous significant thing that he's doing. He is the one bringing the kingdom of God. So you see this here, and Jesus, in fact, you see that Jesus makes explicit the connection between the kingdom and a wedding feast in Matthew 22:2, where he says, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son. Well, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave it. He does the same thing in Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. And by the way, in speaking of himself as the bridegroom, Jesus here, he appropriates for himself imagery that is used in the Old Testament of God. You see in texts like this, you get this hint, you see, where he speaks about being a husband or Israel being the bride, the idea being God is the bridegroom. So here Jesus has a somewhat veiled identification of himself as God by adopting this bridegroom imagery. But they want to know, why aren't they fasting? And he's giving it to them. He's telling them more than I suspect they can comprehend. And then he prophesies in verse 20. He prophesies in verse 20 that the joy and celebration, thus the lack of fasting, that his disciples properly exhibit in his presence, that this joy and this celebration will turn to fasting when he's taken from them. Now, I think what he's referring to there is that he's referring to the temporary mourning that they will experience after his arrest and execution and prior to his resurrection. That temporary mourning that's spoken of in John 16, verses 16 to 22. And he's revealing that his coming violent death, by the way, is something that he knows and embraces. See, he knows it, and he embraces it. Now, I could say more about this when we were talking about the, when we were doing the Sermon on the Mount, I went into a bit more about the fasting and, you know, now he's ascended and you see that fasting was inappropriate when he's present. It's appropriate when he's killed before his resurrection, but now he's ascended to heaven, yet he's here in spirit. So how do those things play out? If you want to look at that, you can go to the notes, theoutlet.us. This study will be there and you can look into that in some more detail. But I have many things to say over the next however long, so I'll just send you to those notes. Okay, Jesus brings the kingdom, this idea of the bridegroom in their midst. And then we have this one of the children playing. Now the marketplaces of the towns and villages of the ancient world, see, that was a natural place for children to congregate and to play together. These marketplaces, parents would go there with the children, and as children do, they wind up getting together and entertaining themselves by playing together, much the way they do on school playgrounds now. You go out to a school playground, what do you got? The kids have cooked up all kinds of junk, whether they're playing tag, hide and seek, I don't know what it is, but they're out there playing together. And so here you are, these marketplaces were places where people would come and bring their children, and the children would naturally get together, and this is where they would entertain themselves by playing together. And Jesus says in Matthew chapter 11, 16 to 19, he says, "But to what shall I compare this generation?" The generation of Jesus' day. "To what shall I compare them? It's like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to their playmates, 'We played the flute for you and you didn't dance. We sang a dirge and you didn't mourn.'" You see what's going on here, right? I mean, this is children who are complaining that the other kids didn't go along with their game, their expectations. "We're playing the celebration game, whether it's the wedding game. You know, we played the flute. And your role was, in response to our playing the flute, was you were to dance. Because that's the game. So you're like children who are saying, 'We played the flute, but you didn't meet our expectations because you did not dance in response to our playing the flute.' Or, 'We sang a dirge, so we're playing what? The funeral game.'" You may say, "Well, what kind of games are these?" I don't know how kids entertain themselves, but obviously they were doing this. So he says here that we sang a dirge. And what was that? That was your cue. When we sang the dirge, your cue was, "Oh, you're to mourn." I could see kids getting a kick out of that. But this generation are like kids who are complaining, "When we sang the dirge, you did not conform to our expectation that you would then go ahead and mourn. We played the flute and you didn't conform to our expectation that you would go ahead and dance. So you are like children doing that." He continues, verse 18. How are they like that? He says, "For John came neither eating nor drinking. And how did they receive that? They did not like that because that didn't meet their expectation. They had in their head some image of John that was off. And so when John came the way he did, they're saying, 'You're not playing right.'" What did they say? "He has a demon. The Son of Man came. He was eating and drinking. Unlike John." But they have the same response. "That is not what we expect of you." And what do they say? "Look at him, a glutton and a drunkard. A friend of tax collectors and sinners." Then he says, "Yet wisdom is justified by her deeds." You see, wisdom is justified by her deeds. Luke 7:35, it says, "Wisdom is justified by all her children." And Jesus is saying to them that for those who are willing to see it, there was perfectly good evidence of God's wisdom at work in Jesus' own ministry. The signs of God's revolutionary activity in Jesus' ministry were present. People could see them. That's what he's doing when he's doing these healings, when he's doing these exorcisms. He's saying that the not yet is invading, the kingdom is coming into the now. I'm ushering in the kingdom. And it was there for people to see in the things that he said, how he lived, what he did. And yet they're sitting back here going, "You didn't do what we wanted. You didn't do like we expected." And he's saying, "But there's evidence here for you to adjust your expectation and to see that your expectation is incorrect. All you have to have are eyes to see, and you would see it." Jesus brings the kingdom, the unshrunk cloth, and the new wine. Well, after Jesus explained in Mark chapter 2, verses 19 to 20, after he explained there and in the parallels why his disciples don't fast, Jesus says in Mark chapter 2, 21 to 22, he says, "No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. If he does, the patch tears away from it, the new from the old, and a worse tear is made. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is destroyed, and so are the skins. But new wine is for fresh wineskins." So Jesus is telling them that the kingdom that he is ushering in, this kingdom that he's bringing, is such a radical new reality such a radical new reality that it cannot be confined to the old patterns of Jewish piety. Remember what they're asking? Why don't you fast? See, why don't you fast? And he's trying to say something bigger is taking place, and it is so big that it can't be shoehorned into these patterns of Jewish piety. It's not a mere tweaking of the status quo that Jesus is bringing. It is the kingdom of God invading the present age. Now, of course, Jesus didn't see himself as starting something completely new. He didn't see himself doing that at all, something that had no connection to the past. That's not correct. Rather, he saw himself as building on and bringing to fulfillment God's plan and purpose revealed in the Old Testament and revealed in the history of the people of Israel. That's why he says in 5:17, remember when we looked at the Sermon on the Mount? He says in chapter 5, verse 17 of Matthew, he said he didn't come to abolish the law and the prophets, but to what? But to fulfill them. You see, so there is a discontinuity with this kingdom that's coming in. It's not just a mere tweaking. There is something that is discontinuous, but there's also a connection. So there is continuity and discontinuity. And so he's telling them this, that your expectation, you are under evaluating the discontinuous aspect of the kingdom. You are missing that by thinking that it's something, a mere tweaking, that can be stuffed into the patterns of Jewish piety, and it cannot. It is something larger and grander than that. And this link with the past, it's indicated in Matthew chapter 13, verse 52. Where it says, and he said to them, therefore, every scribe who's been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. See, what is new and what is old? Wenham comments on that text. He says, Jesus implies that Christian teachers are similar to the Jewish theological experts in some ways. And yet, whereas the Jewish teachers look back to the past, to the great figure of Moses above all, Jesus' disciples had not only the old. See, there is continuity, right? There's this connection back here. He didn't come to abolish, but to fulfill. This is the completion of one story. You see, so he says that he looked back to the past, to the great figure of Moses above all. Jesus' disciples had not only the old, but also great new treasures as well in Jesus and his message of the kingdom being the fulfillment of Moses and the prophets. Let me give you a fairly lengthy quote, just two slides, but from Wenham, his conclusion about the unshrunk cloth and the new wine. And I want to give it to you just because I like it. I think it's powerful. But Wenham says, Jesus was not an iconoclastic revolutionary, smashing everything that had gone before. But he did see his coming as bringing a decisively new stage in God's purpose. Once the space rocket's motors have fired and the rocket lifts off the launch pad, the space mission moves into a quite new and most exciting stage for which everything else has been preparation. So Jesus' ministry represented the liftoff of God's revolution. And things could never be the same again. As with Jesus' parable of the bridegroom and the feast, so with the parables of the patch and the wine, Jesus makes a remarkable claim for himself. He has brought God's promised revolution, his healing, you see. This broken, sick world is going to be what? Corrected, fixed, all things set right. And he says here, he's brought God's promised revolution into the world. God has worked in the history of his people in wonderful ways. But now something of a decisively new order was taking place. You see, this is something tremendously significant that has taken place in Jesus' coming. And that's what this is about when he speaks about himself as the bridegroom and the time for celebration and this. Now, in Luke's account includes, in Luke chapter 5, verse 39, it includes a statement. And no one after drinking old wine desires the new, for he says the old is good. And I think Wenham and many other commentators are correct when they see this as an ironical comment. You see, they see that as an ironical comment on people's resistance to Jesus' ministry. And he sums up the meaning. He says, the conservative old guard who are unwilling to receive the revolution of God are like people extolling the virtues of old wine. But this time, it's the new wine which is far superior. And I think that's how to understand that. You see, Jesus is here bringing this, and some people are going, well, I don't like that. And you see this all through the New Testament. Who are Judaizers? Judaizers are the people who continue to overemphasize the Mosaic covenant and not to realize its function in the overall flow of the story and not to realize Jesus' tremendous impact and what he has done. So you see that same idea. Now, I've got time. Let's see. Can we get through this one? We're going to try. Okay. Now, Jesus' remarkable ministry, it drew the ire of some religious leaders. You're familiar, you know that. See, they couldn't deny his mighty works, but given, see, that he didn't fit with their traditional notions of piety, I mean, hobnobbing with sinners, not engaging in voluntary fasts, not observing the Sabbath in the way they thought he should. See, because he didn't fit with their traditional notions of piety, they concluded in Mark chapter 3, verse 22, and in parallels, that a demon was empowering him. That's their idea. 3:22 to 27, and the scribes who came down from Jerusalem were saying, he's possessed by Beelzebul, and by the prince of demons he casts out demons. They couldn't deny what he's doing. I mean, he was happening. Everybody knew it. You see? They couldn't deny the power that was at work in his ministry. So they tried to discredit it, and this is what they're thinking. They feel like, hey, this guy's not right. He's not pious. He's a fraud. And so they're bringing this up and saying this to people. See, they attributed these things, his remarkable exorcisms, to Beelzebul, to the prince of demons. Now, Jesus showed the implausibility of that accusation. He points out that such serious infighting within Satan's household, well, that would be the end of Satan. If you really had this kind of infighting in Satan's household, you know, that would be it. He says, and he called them to him and he said to them in parables, how can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he can't stand, but it's coming to an end. So they're saying this about Jesus on these tremendous, powerful exorcisms that he's doing, and he's showing them the implausibility of that. You see, he says, do you guys really believe that? You see, do you think that makes sense? That doesn't make sense, does it? Because if Satan's up against himself, then his house is going to be destroyed. He's fighting against himself, you see? And then in Matthew 12, 27, and in Luke 11, 19, he made an additional point by exposing their double standard. He says there, and if I cast out demons by Beelzebul, by whom do your sons cast them out? Your buddies, your disciples, the people you're down with. They're out there casting out demons. So if I'm doing it by demons, by whom do your sons cast them out? And saying that his exorcisms were demonic, in saying that, you see, they were saying implicitly that the exorcisms done by their religious friends, exorcisms they fully embraced, they were cheering those people on. Right? So he says, you calling my stuff demonic? Well, then the exorcisms by implication of those you champion are demonic, and yet you champion them, and so by your logic, you are championing the work of demons. That's why he says, therefore, they will be your judges. You see, they will be your judges. You see, I tell you, I love watching people try to wrestle with Jesus. It's just beautiful. Every time they think we're going to trap him, I said, that's a bad move. We're going to trap him. You're not going to trap him. You see? But he lays that out for him and tells him that. As Wenham notes, he says, Jesus is not suggesting that his exorcisms are no different from those of other exorcists. His exorcisms seem to have been of a different order from those of others. And he cites Mark 1:27. And even his opponents recognize them as such, hence their ascription to them of the chief of demons. Jesus' exorcisms were so remarkable, so powerful, that they said, this guy's got the top dog working for him. They got Beelzebul, the chief of demons. He just doesn't have an underling demon doing this because they're too great and too powerful. Now, Mark 3:27, I don't think I'm going to be able to finish here, but Mark 3:27, he gives the correct explanation of his exorcisms. In 3:27, he says, but no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man, then indeed he may plunder his house. You see, Jesus' exorcisms, they are the opposite of working for Satan. They're an unprecedented expression of power over Satan. Satan is the strong man that Jesus has tied up to be able to take away his goods, that is, to be able to free the people he's taken captive. Satan is the strong man Jesus has tied up. That is how he frees people from his possession. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 28, and in Luke chapter 11, verse 20, Jesus expressly ties his extraordinary exercise of power over Satan in his exorcisms to ushering in the kingdom of God. He says in Matthew 12, 28, but if it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. You see, he ties directly his power in doing this with his role as the kingdom bringer. If that's what's going on, that's what he's doing. He's showing this. This is what's going on. You see, as with his healings and his raisings of the dead, his exorcisms were an illustration of the kingdom's character. It was a foretaste of the final and complete expulsion of all demons at the consummation. Just like you see here, raisings of the dead. Did he raise all the dead? No, but it was an illustration. Did he heal all the sick? No, but it was an illustration of the character of the kingdom. Did he get rid of all the demons? No. But what's he doing? He's showing the nature and the character of the kingdom that he is bringing, that at the consummation, there will be no demons. They will be expelled, and we know where they'll be expelled to. You see? So this is something very powerful when he says what he says there. This binding of the strong man, I heard that bell. This binding of the strong man and what it means. Let me give you this one quote, and then I'll let you go. David Wenham. Jesus' ministry did not, of course, mean the complete overthrow of Satan immediately. We shall see that Jesus' ministry represented the start of the revolution, not its completion, the inauguration, not the consummation. There were crucial battles ahead, not least at Jesus' crucifixion. Nevertheless, the revolution had really begun, and there were unmistakable signs of Satan's downfall. Jesus is the kingdom bringer, and that's what all of these things are showing. Thanks for coming.